Good evening, everyone. I'm Erin Beveridge, a clinical researcher, and on behalf of Canon, I am delighted to be able to welcome all of you to our online Neurology Days. This evening is just the beginning of five very exciting days packed with incredible speakers and really interesting topics. We're going to dive deep into stroke workflows for the first 3 days before we will switch to discuss the more chronic condition of multiple sclerosis. And then finally, we're going to take a closer look at peripheral nerve disease. I really do hope you enjoy the days as much as we have enjoyed bringing them together for you. So tonight we're going to start on our stroke journey. And we're going to begin by looking at the role ultrasound plays in carotid imaging and its potential use in early detection and risk prediction. We have two great talks lined up this evening, and we will have time at the end for discussion. It therefore gives me great pleasure to introduce you to our first distinguished speaker. Professor Neil Pugh is kind enough to be joining us this evening from Wales in the UK. Professor Pugh is highly respected in the field of vascular imaging and has a long-term relationship with Canon. In fact, he's been instrumental in several improvements and developments in vascular ultrasound for Canon over the years, for which we are very grateful. For this session, Professor Pugh is going to speak to us about ultrasound imaging of the carotid artery in stroke assessment and discuss the scope of the problem. And with that, the floor is yours, Professor Pugh.
That's a very kind introduction, and it's my pleasure to be here actually and speak about this today. So welcome everyone. Good evening, good afternoon, or perhaps even good morning, depending on where you are in the world. As I say, it's my pleasure really to start the first of these 3 days on stroke assessment. And I've been asked really just to kick off by talking a little bit about how we use ultrasound to image the carotid artery in stroke assessment. Just a disclaimer, what I'm going to cover today are these points here. So I'm actually going to look at the scope of the problem and how this is associated with carotid artery disease. Then we'll have a look at the diagnostic criteria for the assessment of carotid artery disease. I'll talk a little bit about how we use ultrasound to look for carotid disease. I won't go too much into the detail of how we actually physically do the scan, but we'll just talk a little bit about it. And then a little bit about the pitfalls and the cautions of ultrasound scanning, because one of the problems is, of course, that ultrasound is subjective, and we need to make sure that we're very careful in the way that we proceed with our assessment. And then just conclude it at the end. So we'll start off with the scope of the problem and its association with carotid artery disease. I think we're all aware that vascular disease is a major source of mortality and morbidity in industrial societies. And in fact, myocardial infarction, stroke, and peripheral vascular disease obviously account for a significant death rate, but also a significant proportion of the health spending. Probably globally and certainly in the West. And therefore, the accurate and early detection of vascular disease is, of course, of prime importance. So if we concentrate on stroke, which is, of course, the topic for today, worldwide, there are over 13 million, almost 14 million new strokes each year. And globally, one in four people over the age of 25 will have a stroke in their lifetime. It's in fact the second leading cause of death, and the annual mortality rate is about 5.5 million. But as well as the mortality, we also have obviously a high morbidity, and this results in up to 50% of survivors being chronically disabled. We can classify strokes into two major categories, and those are ischemic strokes and hemorrhagic strokes. And generally speaking, ischemic strokes account for about 80% of stroke cases, while hemorrhagic strokes account for about 20%. The actual proportion of stroke types will actually depend upon the population, but that's roughly the breakdown. And if we look at ischemic strokes, which is what we're interested in terms of carotid artery disease, there were over 9.5 million new cases in 2016. So you can see that the scope of the problem is enormous. How do we assess this and get the patient to be looked at in a timely fashion? Well, most countries will have some form of stroke strategy or some form of framework. In the UK, we have this awareness campaign, which is known as FAST, where obviously if there are any symptoms of stroke in the face, the arms, or the speech, then time is critical, and we need to get the patient in to be assessed in a timely fashion. And as I say, the campaign has been going on for many years in the UK to raise the awareness of the symptoms of stroke and that it's important to get this sorted out. And one of the points about getting the patient in for assessment quickly, obviously, is in terms of treatment and establishing whether this is an ischemic or a hemorrhagic stroke. But even if this is an ischemic stroke, we know that patients who have non-disabling stroke or a TIA, who would be considered candidates for carotid intervention, should have their imaging performed in a timely fashion. And in the UK, the Royal College of Physicians recommend that this is done within 24 hours. What's the rationale for this approach? Well, again, evidence shows that patients who have short-lived symptoms, then they remain at a high risk of further vascular events, and the risk is highest for the first few days. And that's why we need to get this assessed quickly. And therefore, any patient that has an ischemic stroke, we need to image the carotid arteries in a very timely fashion, because if we look at this table down here, we can see that large artery thrombotic stroke occurs in about 20% of the population. So 20% of the time, we're looking for major vessel disease, and one of the vessels, obviously, or one of the major vessels that is going to be implicated in this is the carotid artery. The carotid bifurcation is the most likely site of disease, and that's why this is very amenable to ultrasound imaging. A high proportion of the ischemic strokes are in fact caused by embolism or thrombus from atherosclerotic disease. And we know that atherosclerotic plaques are very complex in their makeup, and I think this will be talked about in the next talk, so I'm not going to go into much detail, but these may be stable or unstable depending upon the composition. So the assessment of the carotid artery and the assessment of the plaque is of prime importance. So what are the recommendations? Well, again, different countries will have different recommendations, but in the UK, the main recommendation is from the Royal College of Physicians, although there are other guidelines, and obviously there are North American and European guidelines. But in general terms, it's thought that the best way of assessing carotid artery disease, at least assessing the narrowing caused by carotid artery disease, is to use the NASET method, the North American Symptomatic Carotid Endarterectomy Trial. And any patient that has had a TIA or a non-disabling stroke with stable neurological symptoms who have a severe carotid stenosis, they should be assessed and referred for carotid endarterectomy as soon as possible, and certainly within 7 days of the onset of symptoms. And when we talk about a severe carotid stenosis, in the UK, we're talking between 50 and 99% stenosis. I know the original NASET trial actually spoke about 70% stenosis, but things have changed over the intervening years. If we have a patient that has a TIA or a non-disabling stroke that has mild or moderate carotid stenosis, and that's less than 50% lumen reduction, these should not undergo carotid intervention and should receive optimal medical treatment. So that's the rationale that's adopted in the UK and also in many other countries as well. So we can go on now to talk a little bit about how we assess carotid artery disease and just have a quick look at the diagnostic criteria that we use, because I think this is very important and we have to understand the diagnostic criteria before we can make an accurate assessment. Historically, we use intra-arterial arteriography. And in fact, both the NASET trial and the European carotid surgery trial used intra-arterial arteriography to measure the degree of stenosis. Of course, this is very much outdated these days because of the obvious complications and problems with it. And there are other modalities that we can use, MRA, for example, and many centers use CTA. But Doppler imaging is another method that we can use, and in fact is probably the only method that has actually been validated against intra-arterial arteriography. And I'll talk a little bit about this in a moment. So since its introduction in the mid to late 1980s, Doppler imaging has really established itself as the first-line investigative technique, because obviously it's non-invasive. It gives both anatomical and functional information. This is very important. It's accurate, it's quick, and it's relatively cheap as well. But it does have the disadvantage that it's user-dependent and also subjective. So why do we use it? Well, as I said, it's quick. It takes about 10 to 15 minutes in most cases. And it's also accurate. Back in 1996, we did a study which we published in the British Journal of Surgery, where we looked at, 198 carotid arteries in 100 patients. And actually, we had a sensitivity of 98% and a specificity of 95%. So you can see that the accuracy of Doppler, when done properly, is very, very good and very comparable with intra-arterial arteriography. And in fact, certainly in the UK, in many centres, this is the only investigation performed, except if we have difficult cases on ultrasound, because there will be technically difficult cases. So how do we grade a carotid stenosis? Because this is another important point. There are, in fact, two different methods for reporting the degree of carotid stenosis, and these give differing results. The first study was the North American Symptomatic Carotid Endarterectomy Trial, the NASIT study. But then very soon afterwards, there was a European study performed as well. Now, both of these are valid techniques, but over the years, it's become generally accepted that the NASIT method should be the preferred method for measuring the degree of stenosis. And this is partly because much of the work that showed that carotid endarterectomy was beneficial was based on the NASIT work, and certainly the NASIT percentage stenosis, which I'll talk about in a moment. So the study, the NASIT study, and actually also the European carotid study, they validated endarterectomy as the treatment choice for recently symptomatic patients with a high-grade stenosis. And that particular time, they were talking about greater than 70% stenosis. Now, as I said, over the years, things may have changed slightly, but certainly 70% stenosis is the point that was originally taken. So how do we calculate the percentage stenosis? As I said, there are two different ways of measuring the stenosis. So the NASIT measurement measures the residual lumen compared with the lumen, or the residual lumen in the internal carotid artery distal to the point of stenosis. So in other words, it's A minus B over A. The European carotid surgery trial actually tried to measure the degree of stenosis at the site of the biggest plaque burden. So it's C, so this distance here, minus B over C. So the two different techniques, as you can see from here, will give two different results. And if I just show you the next slide, you can see that on ultrasound, we can measure the degree of stenosis using both techniques. And if we use the NASIT technique for this particular stenosis or this particular plaque here, you can see that this gives between about a 60 and 70% stenosis, whereas if we use the European method, it gives an 80 to 90% stenosis. So the two measurements are not equivalent. So you have to know which measurement you're making, either the NASIT measurement or the European measurement. They're not interchangeable. And most of the studies are based on the NASIT measurement, because this was an easier measurement to make angiographically. We then had to decide how we use ultrasound, and specifically how we use ultrasound velocities to represent the 70% stenosis. And much of the recommendations that we now use are based on this seminal study that was performed by Grant et al. In 2000. So what this particular study looked at was the peak systolic velocity and also the peak systolic velocity ratio versus the diameter stenosis as measured angiographically. And the upshot of the study was that we had some ranges of both peak systolic velocity and velocity ratios that corresponded to angiographically measured percentage stenosis. And if you look at this table here, you can see that for less than 49% stenosis, then the peak systolic velocity was less than 150. 50 to 69, it was 150 to 225, and greater than 70% stenosis angiographically was greater than 225 centimeters per second. And if we look at the accuracy of this using these, what we found was that the accuracy is shown in the brackets here, that less than 49% stenosis, it was very accurate, 90% for peak systolic velocity, and for greater than 70% stenosis, almost 90% as well. So very good accuracies compared with interarterial arteriography. Where the problem was in the 50 to 69% stenosis. So certainly when we're using greater than 70% stenosis, the cutoff of 225 centimeters per second is well validated. And in fact, then the criteria was developed by, the American Congress of Radiology, and they gave these primary parameters of actually for less than 50%, 125 centimeters per second and 230 centimeters per second, greater than 70%. They also recommended that you do an estimate of plaque volume, plaque stenosis, which I'll talk about in a moment. So you'll see this in the next few slides. This was also corroborated in 2009 by another recommendation that was carried out in the UK. And again, it came out with very similar degrees of velocities. So how do we assess carotid arteries then using ultrasound? Well, we can look at the B-mode appearance. We can look at the spectral Doppler measurements and also color fill-in. The scan range, you have to be aware that we can only scan roughly this area of the neck. So on the right side, that includes the origin of the common carotid artery, but unfortunately on the left side, we can't get at the origin of the common carotid artery and we can't get too far above the bifurcation as well. So that's the scan limitation. As I said, we can look at the B-mode appearance. So here you can see some plaques. And you can see quite nicely that we have a bit of a narrowing going on here. So we use the B-mode image to see the plaque. Obviously, if we're doing plaque morphology, we need the B-mode image. But it gives us an indication of the degree of stenosis that we're likely to see, and also the degree of intimal thickening or minor plaque that we see also. So B-mode imaging is very useful. If we look at the waveforms, then the Doppler waveforms are different in the different carotid vessels. So the common carotid artery shows a waveform like this, which has a slight dichrotic notch here. The internal carotid has a low resistance pattern with a very small dichrotic notch, and the external carotid is a very much more pulsatile waveform, which has a very prominent dichrotic notch. So these are the features that we use to distinguish the internal, external, and common carotid artery. And then we can make the measurements. So we have a normal velocity. In this one here, we have a velocity that is 156 centimeters per second. So that's a 50 to 70% stenosis on the basis of velocity. And this one is 4 meters per second or 400 centimeters per second, and therefore a greater than 70% stenosis. So that's how we would grade the stenosis on the basis of velocity measurements. But we can also look at color fill-in as well. So you can see here we have a small plaque, which is not producing any significant reduction in the lumen. And here we have an anechoic plaque that we can see here. And once again, this looks as though it has more plaque burden, but again, with the NASIT criteria, it's not really producing a great stenosis. Now, the problem with color fill-in is that often it overestimates the degree of residual lumen. And we now have different technologies that we can use that give us better visualization of the lumen. And these are B-flow, but on the Canon systems, we have advanced dynamic flow and superb microvascular imaging. So these two modalities I use a great deal. And I use them because it gives an improved display of surface characteristics. It gives a better depiction of flow channels. It's much better at diagnosing ulceration. And plaque blood flow, you'll hear a little bit more about later. So you can see here, this is a typical color flow image with a lot of, there's obviously something going on here, but a lot of aliasing, and it's difficult to see. If we use ADF, then you can quite clearly see the narrowest point of the residual lumen. You can put your Doppler gate in there to make an accurate velocity measurement, or you can measure the degree of stenosis directly from the image more accurately. Another example here showing the same thing. So again, a very tortuous problem here. And if we look at the advanced dynamic flow, you can see that the maximum stenosis is in this region here, and that actually it's taken a rather tortuous path. So again, that enables us to make an accurate assessment of the degree of stenosis. And just another couple of examples there. This one is quite interesting because you can see there's an exquisitely tight stenosis just at this point here, which is masked on the color flow image. So I would say that if you have advanced dynamic flow, it's a much better way of measuring the lumen diameter. You can also use SMI. Now SMI is quite useful in looking at the flow characteristics around plaque. So you can see this is nice and smooth here. And this one again, a nice smooth plaque around here. So again, this is not necessarily for general diagnostic use, but very useful in research purposes. And if you wanted to, you can also use SMI to look at the flow channels through high flow situations as well. So again, you can see how tight this stenosis actually is. So I would recommend using any of the high resolution imaging that you have. This is an example of ulceration using an old image that is just taken from the internet, and you can see filling in there. But once again, we can do exactly the same thing with SMI. So we have a plaque here, and you can see there looks like a bit of a defect in the cap of the plaque there. And if we put the SMI on, you can see that this is fill-in, and therefore this is an ulcerated plaque. So SMI is very good at showing ulcerated plaques, which have a high association with stroke. You can also use power Doppler as well. This is an old image using power Doppler. I just quickly wanted to just mention a few pitfalls and cautions of ultrasound scanning, because we have to make sure that we get it right. And because ultrasound is very subjective, then we need to know the pitfalls. So these are the main pitfalls. We must choose the correct Doppler angle, and this gives us the correct velocity measurement. We must ensure that the plaque remains extracranial, because otherwise this is not going to be amenable to carotid surgery. We need to identify the correct vessel. If there's trickle flow, we need to know this, because again, this makes it impossible to do a carotid endarterectomy if the plaque is going up into the going right up into the cranium. We need to watch out for calcification, make sure that there's the correct assessment of the degree of stenosis. We can use a curvilinear probe, and we also have to be a little careful if the waveform is changed due to things like aortic valve disease or regurgitation. So just to finish off, I won't read through all of this, but I think what I've shown you is that we can assess carotid artery disease using ultrasound. It's best to use the NASIT method of measurement. Carotid endarterectomy is indicated if you have a 50 to 99% stenosis, but best medical treatment is the way forward if you have a less than 50% stenosis. So that's the end. Here are the references, and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Pugh, for that wonderful, informative talk, full of such great information. It gives us the perfect background to understand carotid artery imaging with ultrasound. And you already touched on SMI, which is actually the perfect segue to our second talk this evening. So on that note, I'm now honoured to introduce our second speaker of the evening, Dr. Mahtab Zamani, who's joining us from Norway. Dr. Zamani is a neurology resident in the neurology department at Oslo University Hospital. And since 2018, she's been involved in clinical research. Her PhD project is a prospective multimodal study on advanced ultrasound methods in assessment of carotid plaque instability with the use of Canon's Superb Microvascular Imaging, or SMI, technology. The results of this promising study were published in the Stroke Journal in 2019. And in this session, Dr. Zamani is kindly going to share the content of that study with you. And with that, I pass the word to you, Dr. Zamani.
Thank you very much for your kind words. I will be presenting a study, as Aaron mentioned. We have published in Stroke in November 2019. So yeah, the title of this study, which is a collaboration between thoracic surgery department, cardiothoracic surgery department, pathology and neurology department, and Oslo University Hospital, is carotid plaque neovascularization detected with superb microvascular imaging ultrasound without using contrast media. As Dr. Pugh mentioned earlier, while some of the ischemic strokes associated with carotid artery stenosis may result from a hypoperfusion due to a significant stenosis of carotid artery, most of them are related to thromboembolism from an unstable atherosclerotic carotid artery plaque. And atherosclerosis, carotid artery stenosis basically, mostly occurs carotid artery bifurcation and involving distal common carotid artery and proximal internal carotid artery. Now, early diagnosis and adequate treatment with carotid endarterectomy, as mentioned earlier, and or stenting would prevent such strokes. Yet the principal indication for carotid revascularization is based on symptomatic status and degree of carotid artery stenosis. Degree of carotid artery stenosis usually is in clinical practice measured by Doppler ultrasound of carotid arteries and or CT angiography. Now, in recent years, it's increasingly clear that the degree of carotid artery stenosis alone is not the best predictor of stroke risk. And this is due to the fact that stroke may occur as a result of a non-stenotic carotid lesion. On the other hand, a significant proportion of patients with significant stenosis remain asymptomatic throughout their entire life. So this is why research in carotid imaging has focused on identifying all unstable or vulnerable plaques, making patients at a future risk of ipsilateral ischemic stroke. Now, earlier histopathological studies have related certain features to unstable plaques, and those are a thin or ruptured fibrous cap, a large lipid-rich necrotic core, increased inflammatory activity, intraplaque neovascularization, and subsequent intraplaque hemorrhage or thrombus. Large lipid-rich necrotic core, increased inflammatory activity, and IPN and IPH contribute to low echogenicity on ultrasound or echolucency on conventional ultrasound. Yes, as Dr. Few earlier mentioned, this consensus panel, I won't go through it in detail, but this is again done by a Society of Radiologists in ultrasound, convened a multidisciplinary panel of experts in the field of vascular ultrasonography to come to a consensus regarding Doppler ultrasound for assisting in diagnosis of carotid artery stenosis. And so this is a table based or taken from this consensus, which is used in clinical routine ultrasound for stratification of carotid artery stenosis. And in this table, PSV stands for peak systolic velocity and EDV stands for end diastolic velocity. And together with B mode grayscale mode ultrasound, this gives us the degree of carotid artery stenosis. Briefly, I mentioned that B mode gives us a possibility of going through intima media thickness and allows us to identify the plaque. We can assess echogenicity of the plaque and we can express ourselves regarding fibrous cap irregularity or ulceration. However, for imaging intraplaque neovascularization, which I will be going through in a bit. Conventional Doppler ultrasound has neither a special resolution nor ability to resolve blood flow in these small microvessels. Now, intraplaque neovascularization, a little bit of a background on arterial wall. Arterial wall, vessel wall, consists of three layers, that is adventitia, media, and intima. Adventitial vasa vasarum normally provides oxygen and nutrition to the vessel wall, and atherosclerosis is a chronic inflammatory disease that starts early in life. And as the vessel wall thickens, hypoxia due to this thickness induces proliferation of this adventitial vasa vasarum microvasculature and extension of them into the full thickness of vessel wall, that is media and intima. And these microvessels, due to deregulation of angiogenic factors and lipid microenvironment, they have immature phenotype, and they are therefore fragile and prone to rupture. They're morphologically defected and therefore highly permeable and leaky. These leaky neovessels are main cause of intraplaque hemorrhage, and intraplaque neovascularization therefore is a strong indicator of future plaque destabilization and rupture. I should mention these vasarum extension into the full thickness of vessel wall they are small in size, and they have a low velocity blood flow, and that is what the problem is with conventional Doppler imaging, where as you can see here, another problem is that conventional Doppler applies a motion wall filter that you can see in this picture as the gray overlapping box. This filter is a motion wall filter is designed to remove the artifact and clutter arising from nearby structure. However, in this process, it may remove the micro circulation as well, as you can see in this picture. Now, contrast-enhanced ultrasound, which is a safe and a semi-invasive method that complements and enhances the standard ultrasound imaging, has shown great promise in visualization of intraplaque neovascularization. However, it uses second-generation contrast agents that are microbubbles consisting of sulfur hexafluorine gas that is encapsulated by phospholipids. And they're approximately 1 to 11 micrometers, that is smaller than red blood cells, and they're not nephrotoxic. This gives the examiner, not nephrotoxic, nephrotoxic means that the patient will breathe them out from their lungs, and therefore examiner with administration of a bolus injection has up to 10 to 11 minutes of examination time. But superb microvascular imaging, which is, as Dr. Pugh mentioned earlier, is a new method developed to overcome the limitations of Doppler, conventional Doppler. It uses an exclusive algorithm. It's a software on a normal Doppler machine, which successfully removes, by the use of this algorithm, successfully removes the artifact and clutter arising from a nearby structure, and at the same time preserves the microvasculature, as you can see in the lower light picture. Whereas the conventional Doppler imaging, as you can see above, cannot show this microvasculature or low velocity blood flow seen as such seen in intraplaque neovascularization. So we took and included 31 patients with above 50% carotid artery stenosis, and 9 of which were asymptomatic patients, and 22 were scheduled for a surgery, that is carotid endarterectomy. And all patients went through neurological examination and a Doppler ultrasound with B-mode, color Doppler and pulsed wave Doppler. And all patients received a contrast enhanced ultrasound with 2.5 milliliter bolus injection of contrast material and were examined for 6 minutes. Superb microvascular imaging was done on all patients and everybody went through blood tests. And 19 plaques were assessed histologically. 19 of plaques taken out by surgery were assessed histologically. I should mention here that 2 of the plaques did not arrive to us for examination. One of them was very calcified. Despite several decalcification process, it was not possible to analyze it under the microscope. And the other one was did not arrive to us due to logistic problems. At histology assessment, plaques were assessed under microscope, and areas with inflammation, granulation tissue, fibrosis, and calcification were determined. And this was done by a scoring system called eyeballing system. It's a semi-quantitative method used in kidney biopsies. We use the modified version. In each plaque, we recorded the number and diameter of vessels with the lumen diameter of 0.01 millimeter and greater in each plaque section. Here you can see the characteristic of plaques we had included in this study, where 5 plaques were determined to be 50 to 69% stenosis of internal carotid artery, and 26 plaques did have above 70% internal carotid artery stenosis. With the B-mode ultrasound, plaques were divided into 4, the one uniformly hypoechoic, predominantly hypoechoic, and predominantly hyperechoic, and uniformly hyperechoic plaques. And for SMI and contrast enhanced ultrasound, in SMI we call the enhancement intraplaque microvascular flow, since there is no contrast material involved. And in contrast enhanced ultrasound, so it's called microbubble enhancement, basically. We used a visual grading system, a semi-quantitative system, starting at 0 to 4, where 0 was no intraplaque microvascular flow signals were seen, or if they were seen, they were confined to the adjacent adventitia. And further on, grade 1 was when moving intraplaque microvascular flow signals were confined to the adventitia side. Note that they were moving, not stationary. And grade 2 were when moving intraplaque microvascular flow signals were seen at the plaque shoulder. And grade 3 was when intraplaque microvascular flow signals were moving to the plaque core. And grade 4 was extensive intraplaque microvascular flow signals. And the same grading system was used for contrast enhancement on contrast enhanced ultrasound. We analyzed SMI and contrast enhanced ultrasound visually with the grading system I just mentioned. And I should also mention that contrast enhanced ultrasound comes with a quantitative inbuilt software. This software plots time intensity curve that gives us peak intensity, which is a value, a maximal intensity in a given time in a given region of interest. We painted around the plaque, entire plaque, and included the entire plaque as a region of interest. And we placed a circular region of interest in lumen, arterial lumen. And we then plotted time intensity curve and obtained peak intensity of the plaque in comparison to of that in lumen. SMI does not come with any quantitative software. It is basically visually assessed. To have a quantitative measure of the analysis, we looked at a 2-minute video in each patient taken by SMI, and we counted a number of neovessels observed in these 2-minute videos, and that was called SMI count. The goals of this study was to see if intraplaque neovascularization can be identified with SMI, and to compare SMI findings and contrast enhanced ultrasound using histology as gold standard. We found that with increasing degree of intraplaque microvascular flow signal on SMI, the degree of enhancement on contrast enhanced ultrasound also increased. That is, the degree on a visual assessment or semi-quantitative assessment, and that was grade 3. And an increasing rate of intraplaque microvascular flow signal SMI was significantly correlated to the increasing number of neovessels at histology, and as well as large areas of inflammation and granulation tissue. Also, we found that SMI count and peak intensity, the two quantitative measurements of the two modality, were significantly correlated. We also found that hypoechoic plaques with low echogenicity had a higher grade of intraplaque microvascular flow signal on SMI and contrast enhancement on contrast enhanced ultrasound, and also higher value of peak intensity on quantitative contrast enhanced ultrasound. And this, I should also mention, the first primary and secondary finding we had suggest that SMI can accurately detect and analyze intraplaque neovascularization with an accuracy comparable to contrast enhanced ultrasound. And the fact that hypoechoic plaques have been associated with the increased risk of plaque rupture and future stroke, and the fact that our finding shows that intraplaque microvascular flow was detected on SMI and contrast and ultrasound, and it was related to hypoechoic plaques at conventional ultrasound, should prompt physicians to investigate for further intraplaque neovascularization when presented with a hypoechoic plaque on the conventional ultrasound. Here is a picture taken from our publication. You're looking at contrast enhanced ultrasound on the picture A, which is to your left, and SMI, superb microvascular imaging, which is the middle picture, and histological slide. This is an above 70% prominently hypoechoic plaque on the near wall of left internal carotid artery in a symptomatic patient. In the picture A, contrast enhanced ultrasound, the influx of contrast material is in yellow, as you can see, and the arrow is pointing at contrast material enhancement, the plaque moving towards the plaque core, grade 3. And in the middle picture, B, picture B, you're looking at the SMI picture, where in SMI blood is colored in white and the plaque is colored black. And the green box is the region of interest where it's placed carefully to include the entire plaque. And again, the arrow points at the neovessel moving toward the plaque core. And picture C, which is a histological slide, is the arrow is pointing at the neovessel. You can see that by observing the endothelial cells. This is how we observe these neovessels under the microscope. We identify endothelial cells, and we directly therefore identify plaque microvessels and counted the number of them and also the diameter of them for each plaque. Here is a video I'm going to show you, where there is a twin view side by side. To the left is a B mode ultrasound, and to the right is the SMI ultrasound. Again, the green box is the region of interest, and in the left picture, which is B mode ultrasound, the plaque is white, and in the right picture, which is SMI, the plaque is colored black, and the blood is painted white. So you can clearly in this video see the presence of intraplaque neovascularization coming from vessel wall towards the plaque core. And the next video is showing the to the left is the contrast enhanced ultrasound, and to the right is a B mode ultrasound. Again, side by side twin view, where to the left the plaque is black and the yellow is influx of contrast material, and by the B mode ultrasound to the right, you can see the plaque is not so well visible. And here the cursor is also moving simultaneously in two pictures, and it's indicating the contrast enhanced ultrasound, contrast enhanced enhancement within the plaque. I will show you in a still picture, zoomed in still picture of the same video, where the arrows point at the contrast micro bubbles in plaque shoulder. That is a great two enhancement. Here is also another example of to the right SMI examination of 70 above 70% stenosis of a carotid artery. This one was a right carotid artery and on the far wall. This was a pure hypoechoic plaque. As you can see to the left is a B mode examination by conventional ultrasound, where plaque is almost not visible. And with ultrasound, you can, with SMI, you can see to the right that both the plaque is well visualized, and also within the plaque you're looking at a neovessel going towards the plaque core. Here I will mention that inflammation plays a key role in atherosclerosis. Macrophages and T lymphocytes are recruited in early stages of this this disease. Macrophages ingest oxidized lipoproteins and they become foam cells. And as cytokines and growth factors are produced, there will be more inflammatory cells recruited to the plaque site. And later on, smooth muscle cells migrate into the intima, and they promote formation of a fibrous cap. And with the death of foam cells and smooth muscle cells, a lipid-rich necrotic core is formed. But at the same time, the surviving smooth muscle cells, they attenuate inflammation by triggering fibrosis. Fibrosis is supposed to stabilize the plaque. However, fibrosis starts with formation of granulation tissue. Granulation tissue is rich in microvasculature, microvasculature that is prone to rupture. They're leaky microvasculature. Here I'm showing you a picture of a neovessel in the granulation tissue. The arrow is pointing at the neovessel itself, and the arrowhead is pointing at erythrocyte outside this neovessel, which suggests that erythrocyte extravasated from this neovessel. And in the next picture, in contrast, I'm showing you a neovessel, the above structure, which is the arrowhead is pointing at. That is a neovessel. It's near a large area of a calcification, which arrow is pointing at. If you notice, there is no nucleus in the massive calcium area. And so you can clearly see outside this neovessel above, there is no extravasated erythrocyte. This suggests that this is in a stable part of the plaque, a more stable neovessel. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much, Dr. Zamani, for such a brilliant presentation. It's really exciting to hear about the promise of SMI as a non-invasive option for the assessment of carotid plaque instability. So we can now go to the live Q&A session. So I've got both Dr. Zamani and Professor Pugh back with me now. So if you've not already submitted questions, please do so via the Q&A function. But for now, I think we can get started with some that have come in whilst you were both presenting. So if we kick off, Professor Pugh, you mentioned in your talk about how patients with TIA are at risk of having another stroke within 4 days, but then mentioned that endarterectomy should be done within 7 days. So the question is, why would you not do the endarterectomy earlier?
Yeah, I mean, in reality, you should do the endarterectomy as soon as possible. I mean, the fact is that, you know, often for other reasons, workup and all the rest of it, it takes time. But you're absolutely right. I mean, it's the sooner you can make the assessment and the sooner the surgery is done, the greater chance you have of stopping subsequent events. So the earliest possible is the best way forward. But just for practical reasons, it's just a matter of trying to get it within 7 days. That might not be the same for all countries. I mean, that's just a recommendation within the UK. But the bottom line is really that the endarterectomy should be done as soon as possible.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. The next question is asking whether you would apply the same rules with Doppler and MRA when you were calculating stenosis.
Yeah, the answer to that question is yes. I mean, the whole rationale for measuring the degree of stenosis was based on those two studies, the European carotid and the NACIT one, and the NACIT being the most important. And the method of measuring holds true for ultrasound measurements, obviously not velocity measurements. Velocity measurements are a surrogate for the percentage stenosis. But if you're doing direct measurements, you should do a NACIT measurement, which can be done on ultrasound, MR or CT, but it should all be done that way, because that was the way that the original studies were set up.
Okay, perfect. Thank you very much. And just to bring Dr. Zamani back into the conversation, we have a specific question on your study. So you mentioned you included 31 patients with 50% stenosis. And the question is, did you use ultrasound B mode or CT angiography to measure the stenosis?
No. There were 31 patients with above 50% of stenosis, and everybody went through a Doppler ultrasound for extensive examination. They went through B-mode Doppler, pulse-wave Doppler, and color Doppler, and degree of stenosis, and alongside plaque morphology that can be done by a conventional Doppler ultrasound was done on every 31 patients. It is CT angiography was not one of our criteria for degree of stenosis, as what our project's goal was to compare ultrasound, advanced ultrasound, with conventional ultrasound. Thank you for your question, by the way.
Thank you for the clarification. So there's another question here, and I'll open it up to both of you. What do you think about Doppler ultrasound for diagnosis of carotid web?
Yeah, well, carotid web, I assume we're talking about hyperplasia, intramuscular hyperplasia. It's quite a rare condition anyway. It's not a common condition. It does occur within any artery. I mean, it's renal arteries and carotid arteries are particularly prone to it. The problem with webs is that it's a very narrow stenosis. So it's not like having a plaque where you can see the extent of the plaque and you can see the stenosis. It's very, very narrow. And I think one of the problems in the past has been that if you use conventional ultrasound, because of the aliasing that goes on due to the tight stenosis, it completely masks the web. And this is another advantage of using something like SMI or ADF, ADF probably, in that because you don't get the degree of aliasing occurring, and certainly with SMI you don't get the aliasing occurring, you can actually see the point of the stenosis much easier than you can with conventional color Doppler. So I would say that I think sort of carotid webs or webs anywhere that you're looking for on Doppler are quite difficult, but the saving grace is that they're quite rare.
Okay, great. Thanks. That's really useful.
We actually have used SMI on carotid webs since I have it available. And it's very, very possible to eliminate the aliasing effect, and also very good in regards to hemodynamic turbulent flow, because SMI is very good at showing the blood flow direction, and the turbulent blood flow is very well shown, because one of the problems with carotid web is actual turbulent flow. And so, and also the web itself, and sometimes it is a moving web, and so it flaps around with the blood flow, and SMI can visualize that when conventional ultrasound is often disturbed by the aliasing effect, where there is a shadowing, acoustic shadowing over the flap, and it doesn't show the webs flapping around.
Great, thanks for your insight on that as well. Really useful. So we have quite a practical question here for you, Dr. Zamani. So you talked a lot about the benefits of SMI, and can you use SMI on all probes, or is this exclusive to the vascular probes?
You can use SMI on all probes.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. And again, specific to your presentation, Professor Pugh, you gave us a lot of information around the NASET guidelines, and someone's asking, what would the therapy choice be if the NASET measurement criteria meets less than 50% stenosis and the Doppler measures greater than 230 centimeters per second in the internal carotid?
Yeah, I mean, I think the problem is that it's quite clear in terms of the treatment. If it's greater than 50% or 70%, then carotid endarterectomy is the choice. If it's less, then it's best medical treatment. The problem is that, as I said earlier, that the measurement of velocity is a surrogate for trying to assess the degree of stenosis. And historically, if we go back historically, the reason that the velocity measurements were made was because we didn't have color flow. And therefore, we couldn't measure residual lumen. If we had been able to measure a residual lumen right at the very start, when those studies were done, we might not be using velocity measurements. So because the velocity measurement is a surrogate, and because it's based on, if you remember the graphs that I showed you of the original grant paper in 2000, the velocity measurement that you choose is just going to be an average. There's going to be error bars on each of those points, so that we choose 230 centimeters per second to be a 70% stenosis. But actually, in reality, there will be a range of velocities, probably from somewhere like 180 to 270, that actually make up that average of 230. So a direct comparison of velocities and a B-mode measurement is in fact very difficult. So I think what you have to do is you have to go on which of those measurements you think is representing the truth of the situation. And in my opinion, if you get a good residual lumen, and particularly if you get a good residual lumen using something like SMI or ADF, I would go with the direct measurement that I make rather than the velocity. I don't know if you agree with that, Dr. Zamani?
Yeah, so you basically using the table consists both of us showed today, consensus by the Society of Radiologists, you take in consideration both the luminal engorgement, basically visually, in both transverse plane and longitudinal plane, and at the same time, you measure PSV values, peak systolic values, blood velocity, there is the maximal engorgement again, and divided by the distal common carotid artery where the blood velocity is normal, and you arrive to a ratio. So this consensus panel is quite descriptive. It uses all possible modalities at hand, basically.
The problem is, never mind what modalities you use, you will sometimes have a discrepancy between what you see and what you measure. Mm-hmm. And when you have that discrepancy, so it doesn't matter whether you use peak systolic velocity ratios, or you do a direct measurement. In fact, sometimes all three of those measurements can actually give a different result. I suppose the question is, if you have a different result in all three, which do you use? There is no definitive answer to that. But my feeling is that if you can get a very good, accurate direct measurement, then the direct measurement is actually what the velocities are trying to tell you. So the velocities are a surrogate for a direct measurement. So if you have a direct measurement on ultrasound, and if you have a discrepancy between different modalities, then or the Doppler and the direct measurement, in my opinion, I think it would be better to go with a direct measurement. You always have the option of having a completely different investigation. So you could go for MR or CT. But then you have problems with that, because they may not give you the same answer either.
Yes.
And then you come in, which is the gold standard.
Direct measurement is often the solution in hectic daily days at a hospital. The direct measurement is most of the time the salvation when one has this problem, and also when one has artifact shadowing or aliasing. Yeah. Or confetti sign by blood velocities generally.
Yeah, no, I agree. So I think direct measurement would be my answer. Long-winded answer, but an answer.
Perfect, great discussion. Thank you both very much for that. So perhaps this is a question to both of you. Dr. Pugh talked a lot about the use of carotid imaging in symptomatic patients. And we know that the latest recommendations is still not to screen in asymptomatic high-risk patients. But do you think there's a future role for SMI for screening in this population?
Maybe Dr. Zamani, maybe that's a question for you rather than me.
But could you repeat the question one more time?
Sure. So we talked a lot about the use of carotid imaging in symptomatic patients, so patients who have had TIA or other. And we're talking about whether or not there's a role for screening asymptomatic but high-risk patients. Do you think there's a future role for SMI for screening in this population?
Absolutely. SMI is giving us information of plaque morphology. It shows our plaque at best. It's possible to see inside it. So if you have an asymptomatic patient where Doppler velocities basically give you a sort of a degree of a stenosis where patient might end up in a certain follow-up, and you find the patient at high risk, because you have occlusions on normal ultrasound. Our study actually showed that if you do have an occlusions on ultrasound, one should be prompt to go ahead and examine or look for further intraplaque neovascularization or hemorrhage. So SMI could be useful in imaging both symptomatic patients and asymptomatic patients.
Great, thank you.
I think with asymptomatic patients, it's an interesting point in that we get significant stenoses in asymptomatic patients. I think Dr. Zamani touched on this earlier on in her talk. So there are other factors involved. So plaque morphology is a very important factor. So I think that it's not just about sort of percentage stenosis, it's also about plaque morphology. So I think, you know, in terms of anything that can help with the plaque morphology, and I think SMI helps both with the intraplaque flow, but also perhaps with the turbulence of flow around plaques. And both of those are important in patients who don't necessarily have high-grade stenoses.
Great. Thank you both very much. It's interesting to see where this might go in the future. I think we're close to being out of time now, so I'd like to thank the audience for the great questions and to thank both of you for your opinions and that really great discussion at the end there. So that brings us to the end of day one. And once again, I'd like to thank both our speakers, Professor Pugh and Dr. Zamani, for kicking our neurology days off to a great start. Thank you all for joining and see you tomorrow.
Thank you.